Hello students, I hope you are doing fine. Today let me discuss something about the third section of the poem titled The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. It is very interesting to know about the third section or third part of this poem titled The Ancient Mariner. And before this, just to make you thorough, let me revise some important points of the poem once again. The Rime of the Ancient Mariner is a poem written in the form of a ballad. It consists of 625 lines and the poem is divided into seven parts or sections. It is based on the dream of a friend of the poet. It is about an old sailor, an ancient mariner, and is set in ancient times. It is a story of sin, punishment, and redemption of this old sailor. The poet gives us an important message that those who harm and torture others can never have peace of mind. The sinner, as well as those who support him, are eventually punished by God. The beginning of this poem is as a group of wedding guests is going to a marriage feast when one of the guests is stopped by an old sailor. He is eager to tell him his story. The sailor forces him to stop and listen to his story. The sailor narrates his story that how their ship sailed from the harbor on a happy note. They had a smooth journey for some time, after which a storm forced their ship southwards toward the land of snow and mist. And at that moment, an albatross came flying through the fog. And first of all, this albatross was treated to be a noble soul, a sign of good luck, a holy messenger of God. Its arrival was considered to be a good omen, as with its arrival, the snow cracked and gave way to the ship, which once again started sailing. The holy bird flew along with the ship and was fed by the crew. A favorable south wind blew, which drove the ship out of the cursed land of snow and mist. The sailors thanked the bird as it was a good omen for them. At the moment, the sailor's face became sad and wedding guest asked him the reason for it. The sailor said that in the spur of the moment, he had shot the bird to death with his crossbow. His fellow sailors blamed and cursed him for killing the holy bird, but later they felt that he was right in killing the bird which had brought the fog and mist. For some time the ship kept on sailing smoothly towards the northern direction. Suddenly the wind stopped blowing and the ship came to a halt. After some time their stock of drinking water finished. The ship was surrounded by the water of the sea, but the crew did not have a single drop of water to drink. The sea was so quiet that it seemed too hot and strange. Creatures move on its surface. They felt that the bird's soul had followed their ship to take revenge. The sailors could not speak due to their dry throats. They looked at the mariner with hatred. They replaced the crossbow in his neck with the dead albatross bird to signify his sin and guilt. So students, let me start the third part of this poem. The old mariner was narrating his story. The mariner and his shipmates were in dire distress. They were in much difficulty. Their throats were dry in want of water. Their lips were dry. Their tongue were dry. They were feeling thirst a great deal. Then after, the ancient mariner looked towards the west and saw some object like a dot. Gradually, it became bigger and looked like a patch of mist. Later on, this patch of mist began to have a definite shape, but the shape was not definite and clear. It began to change its way because some spirit of the water was following it. The lines are also very important. At first, it seemed a little speck, and then it seemed a mist. It moved and moved and took at last a certain shape I wished. At first, it seemed a little speck, and then it seemed a mist. It moved and moved and took at last a certain shape I wished. Next stanza. I speck a mist, a shape I wished, and still it neared and neared, as if it dodged a water spirit. It plunged and tacked and whizzed. I speck a mist, a shape I wished, and still it neared and neared, as if it dodged a water spirit. It plunged and tacked and whizzed. Then after, the ancient mariner looked towards the west and saw some object like a dot. Gradually it became bigger and looked like a patch of mist. Later on, this patch of mist began to have a definite shape, but the shape was not definite and clear. It began to change its course because some spirit of the water was following it. On account of excessive heat and thirst, their throats and lips were dry. They could neither laugh nor cry. Drought had made them speechless. They could not utter a word due to utter drought. The mariner was thirsty a great deal. The mariner was thirsty a great deal. The lines, with throats unslacked, with black lips begged, we could not laugh nor wail. Through utter drought, all dumb we stood. I bit my arm, I sucked the blood and cried, a sail, a sail. With throats unslacked, with black lips baked, we could nor laugh nor wail. Through utter drought, all dumb we stood. I bit my arm, I sucked the blood and cried, a sail, a sail. The shipmates' throats were also parched, and their lips were dry with thirst. The mariner was thirsty a great deal. The ancient mariner slacked his throat by biting his arm and sucking his own blood. Then after, the mariner cried out that a ship was approaching them. The shipmates' throats were also parched and their lips were dry with thirst. They heard his shout with surprise. Then they thanked God and expressed their joy. They drew in their breath as if they were drinking water. The ancient mariner pointed out to his companions that the ship had become all right. It was gradually approaching him and would bring them help. It was strange that though there was neither tide nor wind, yet the ship was sailing